First of all, I would like to thank the guys in the committee for inviting me to this honorable meeting. The talk today is about water. Water as a therapy for renal patients. A few years ago, the International Renal Society advocates that we all should drink water a lot. But which water? Now, it's a benefit that our planet is a watery planet. So Earth has been called the water planet because 80% is covered with water or ice, but less than 2% of Earth's water is drinkable. So it's a lot of water, but just little is drinkable. And we use water a lot for different things. Water is very good, actually. It is the universal solvent, and it is the best solvent known. It is a solvent in our bodies and in any living creature body. It attacks both positive and negative ions, so it can distribute any other solution inside it. And we use it a lot for washing like that. But as I said, which water? Because most of the water that we encounter is not a drinkable water, it's not a water that we can use because it is of high salinity, 3.5% salinity. And this is to tell that most of the water in our planet is of high salinity. So we cannot drink it, and I will just explain why. These are the types of water that we might encounter coming from the top to the brine water, then the saline water, then the brackish water, and the one that we can drink after purification is the fresh water. So why can't we drink salt water? It's just water, as I said, but we can't do that because if we drink salt water, so we take a lot of salt, and this salt needs more water to be excreted through the kidney. So actually, when we drink seawater, we are going into a negative balance of water, not a positive balance. So we lose water by drinking seawater. So this is why we cannot do that. Drinking seawater makes us dehydrated. And we can think of humans and animals as well as water, as human bodies. Our bodies represent a certain amount of gallons of water. And we nearly 60% of our body is water, a little bit less in females, a little bit more in children and young adults, and a lot more in infants. So we are a watery creature. Water is required to replace our losses. We lose water insensibly, we lose water in urine, we lose water in sweating, and we lose water in fecal loss. And we tried a lot to estimate how much of the daily water we require in unstressed healthy adults. And there have been a lot of controversy, but based on the metabolic rate, it's 80 to 100, 110 mils per 100 kilocal. Based on body surface, it's 1.5 per square meter. And based on the weight, it's 30 to 40 mil per kilogram per day. Which water then? Is the same if we drink the natural water or a soft beverage? All are fluid. Are all fluids the same? Actually, it's not. And I will explain this in a moment. And we excrete water and use water in a counter current exchange by the vasa recta in the kidney. So the kidney is an important organ that excretes water and excretes salt in parallel. But actually, the excretion of water and salt can be preferentially different, taking some regulation from higher center in the body, especially the brain, the hypothalamus, the pituitary, through an antidiuretic hormone, which can work on a specific water channel to allow for more absorption or less absorption of water, let alone salt. So it has been said long, long time ago that water might be the best medicine. Let us see. Treatment of nephrolysis has been long acknowledged for being benefited of water. But non-renal condition can also benefit from water, like bladder cancer, colorectal cancer, and potentially coronary artery disease. But these data are just subjective data. But there are putative therapeutic effect of water, especially in renal disorders like nephrolithiasis, as we know. Some advocate its use in chronic kidney disease, and more recently, autosomal dominant polycystic kidney disease, as I will show. And there has been some rise about 8x8. Is how much water do we need a day? It's 8 times 8 ounce water. So it's nearly 8 cups a day. It's more than 2 liters a day. This is what have been advocated many years ago by Jane and Brody in the New York Times, nearly 2000. And there have been some debate whether this is important, whether there is a hazard about that. But drink at least 8 glasses of water, is there scientific evidence of that? Actually, there is no. But we passed into a world of hydromania. All people in the United States and many other areas in the world were rushing for drinking water, and they used the bottled water, which has some risks, as I will show. Out of application has been passed then from the 2000 up to currently about water drinking and its benefits. Can water be used to prevent cancer? There have been some publication about the reduction of bladder cancer by water, telling that when the urine is more dilute, there is less irritation of the bladder wall, and there might be protection from bladder cancer. And this can show you elegantly in the last line that the more you drink water, the less is the risk for developing bladder cancer. Water and other fluid and the fatal coronary disease. Can water be protective of coronary disease? A high versus low intake of fluid other than water was associated with a relatively risk of 2.47 in women and 1.46 in men of developing fatal coronary artery disease. So this is not speaking about water, it's speaking about other soft beverages. But why may coronary heart disease be increased with a higher intake of fluid other than water? Because some of them are caffeinated beverages, which have mild diuretic, and some of them have high energy drinks that can cause a lot of atherosclerosis, and some of them can stimulate the duodenum for a lot of reactions. It is known that low urine flow reduces the capacity to excrete a sodium load. So we need high water intake to excrete sodium. So if you don't have good water intake, then you might retain your sodium in the body, and you pass into problem with sodium retention, and we pass into hypertension and edema. Fluid intake from food and the beverages excluding water is not associated with improved kidney function or reduced mortality. In a research done many years ago, actually in the 2014, and it might be that water might be different from that, but we cannot be sure about that. And there have been some challenges of linking chronic dehydration and the fluid consumption to health outcome. Urine volume and the change in estimated glomerular filtration rate in community-based cohort study in a research published in 2011 showed an inverse graded relationship evident between urine volume and estimated GFR. The more the urine volume, the less the GFR decline. And chronic kidney disease patients, when they use water intake in a trial called WIT, there have been a notion that hydration group with increased water intake were better, but actually there were significant change in urine, serum osmolality, or electrolyte concentration, or estimated GFR between the high and the low water intake. So this was a negative result. And it has been said that man in the desert has got a certain physiology, and he lives in a dehydrated manner, in a chronic dehydration that might have some health hazard. Water intake might have some implication on the progression of chronic renal failure in animals. So the more you give the animal water after 5-6 nephrectomy, the better the rat does regarding his kidney function. As you can see here, the first column here is a rat with diabetes insipidus, and this is a rat with treated diabetes insipidus, and here is a rat with high water intake and a control rat, and a rat with an antidiuretic hormone treatment. As you can see, there is increase in kidney weight with the treated diabetes insipidus, which is decreased when we give high water intake. So the kidney undergoes hypertrophy when its concentration activity is increased chronically. But this pattern is similar by increasing activity induced by partial restriction of water or vasopressin infusion or by increase in protein consumption. The three are the same, causing renal hypertrophy and increase in renal weight. And this can contribute to the progression of chronic renal failure. In diabetic rats, we thought that vasopressin can contribute to the development of diabetic nephropathy. And they noticed that plasma glucose increased 3 times in diabetic rats of both strains, but glucose secretion was 40% lower in diabetes insipidus and diabetes mellitus than in non-diabetes insipidus, diabetes mellitus, with less intense metabolic disorders. This means that creatinine clearance would increase significantly in non-diabetes insipidus, diabetes mellitus, but fail to increase in diabetes insipidus, diabetes mellitus. But urinary albumin excretion increased twice in non-diabetes insipidus, diabetes mellitus, by rose by only 34% in diabetes insipidus, diabetes mellitus. So diabetes insipidus might be a bit protective against proteinuria and deterioration of kidney function and renal hypertrophy. In another study, renal function was studied under fasting condition and after a meat meal in 12 healthy adults on a low and high hydration regime of 0.5 to 4 milliliters of oral water per kilogram body weight over 30 minutes respectively. And you can see that the high hydration, there is decrease in the plasma flow. So in conclusion, in fasting adults, high hydration decreased GFR, increased natriuresis. After a meat meal, GFR increased only in high hydration region and the natriuresis only in the low hydration group. So in conclusion, sustained high urine volume and low urine osmolality are independent risk factors for faster GFR decline in patients with chronic renal insufficiency. Here in polycystic kidney disease, we can see that rats on the left side are males above and females down are polycystic rats with normal water intake. And on the right hand, the B and D are the same experiments of rats but under high water intake. You can see clearly that the size of the kidney has decreased after high water intake. You can see that the cyst area is decreased in the black colon with high water intake compared to the control polycystic kidney. And also the kidney weight is a lot decreased. And the PCNA, which is a marker of proliferation, and apoptosis index are better in those taking high water intake in animals. So increased water intake for 10 weeks will decrease the AVP secretion and decrease urine osmolality, and can make things better for the polycystic kidney disease in rats. In another study, the participants with high quantile fluid intake had a significantly lower risk of chronic kidney disease than those with high water intake. So there have been a lot of work about the association, but most of it is controversial. This type of research didn't show any difference between high water intake and low water intake in chronic kidney disease patients. But it is well known that rehydration with soft drinks like beverage exacerbate dehydration and worsen dehydration associated with renal injury. And the coaching of patients to increase water intake of the kidney is published North American Medical Association in 2018. Those patients who are coached to increase the water intake didn't show any particular benefit after 1 year of drinking a lot of water. There is an ongoing randomized controlled trial of high versus liver water intake in patients with autosomal dominant polycystic kidney, and the results are still awaiting. But there are some possible hazards of a high water intake, like water intoxication with hyponatremia, non-fatal hyponatremia, exposure to pollutants, and inconvenience and expense of the water. Some hazardous chemicals are present in the water, like in bisphenol, like polyethylene, tetraphthalate, like phthalates. And there are 6 tips published by the National Kidney Foundation about water drinking. 8 is great, but not set in stone, not enough. Less is more if you have kidney failure. So less is more if you have kidney failure. Do less. It is possible to drink too much water, but be careful of hyponatremia. Your urine can reveal a lot. Look at the urine. Water helps prevent kidney stones and UTI. Beware of the pills and the procedures. In summary, nephrolithiasis is the clearest indication of high water need. But water is definitely better than other soft beverages. Thirst is still important. You have to depend on it and be wise in advocating much water drinking, especially in renal disease, and data are still controversial regarding the ideal amount of drinking water in each case.